squared. So here's the question. If x squared minus y squared equals 100, and if x plus y equals 2, then x minus y equals, and then you have your answer choices. So go ahead. If you need to go back and look at those common quadratic equations, do so. Give this problem a try and see how you do. All right, how'd you do? Hopefully you recognize something very, very important. Maybe because I tipped you off to it, but maybe because you're starting to recognize this. And that is, you look at a question like this, use green this time. If x squared minus y squared equals 100, and if x plus y equals 2, then x minus y equals what? And we have our answer choices. And you should have had, again, those light bulbs going on, those red flags going up, as soon as you saw that. Because you should have recognized that as one of our common quadratic equations, right? At the very worst, you should have been able to reverse FOIL it, but as soon as you see a square term, light bulbs should be going off. And what do we see? Well, we recognize that as that first common quadratic equation. And that first common quadratic equation, again, driving through the fog with headlights on, you should do something, you could do something, even if you don't see how the whole question is going to unfold. We know that x squared minus y squared is one of those common quadratic equations, one of those three common quadratic equations, the roots of which are what? What, when multiplied together, is going to produce that? Well, you should remember it's x plus y times x minus y, right? That's the whole point. That's the whole point of memorizing those, learning those, putting those on flashcards until they become second nature. Again, could you reverse FOIL that? Could you figure it out on test day? Of course. But could you also save yourself a lot of time and headache by just learning the common quadratic equations? Yeah, it's so much easier. And so then if that equals 100, then certainly that's got to equal 100. And that's going to be in a much more user-friendly form, right? X plus y times x minus y equals 100. Because those things are synonymous. Those roots produce that, and so they must also equal 100. And then we continue to look at the question. So if that equals 100, which means those factors multiplied together equals 100, and if x plus y equals 2. Ah, what do we notice? Well, the beauty is we've taken that quadratic equation, we've broken it out into its factors, and what do we notice? One of those factors is exactly what the question gives us information about. Right? It's no coincidence that the test gives us x plus y equals 2. X plus y, that term, equals 2. So that times x minus y equals 100. And then what is the question asking? The question is asking, what then is x minus y? Well, x minus y is a term that will be isolated if we just divide both sides by 2. So that we're left with x minus y equals 50. Right? Now, you're probably just smiling to yourself saying, ah, it's interesting how that all comes together. I couldn't do it on my own, but it looks so easy when you do it, Brett. Well, it should look easy after I do it, but now that I have done it, and now that you have seen it, hopefully you recognize that this is exactly what you're looking for. It's not going to be any different than this on test day. It just might be different. Maybe it'll be a very similar question, but for one of the other three common quadratic equations. In this case, we happen to use this one, and everything just fell into place, and there you go. The answer is D. You check it and move on. Let me say something very, very important. Take a look at this. You may notice that in this question, it is asking us for what is x minus y. This is something important, not only on quadratic equation questions, but really all problem-solving questions on the GMAT. Here's a tip for you. If you are asked to solve for a term, an entire term, like in this case, x minus y, or maybe you're solving for 2x plus 1, or whatever it is. If it's something more than just solving for an individual variable, like what is x or what is y, in this case it's what is x minus y, you are almost never supposed to solve for the individual variables and then add them together or subtract them together. So if you started going down the path of trying to figure out what x is, and then figuring out what y is, and then thinking you could just subtract them to get the right answer, you're almost never going to be able to solve these questions that way. It should be a tip-off to you that if you see a question that's asking you to solve for the term, you want to try to solve for the entire term intact. And that should maybe be a little bit kind of driving through the fog with headlights. Again, it should tell you, hey, I need to do something to look for this term intact. How can I do that? And that if you were going down the wrong path, it may put you back on the right path to at least have that realization, and maybe you figure some things out about the quadratic equations, just as you saw me do here, that isolates that term in its entirety because you recognize it's part of that common quadratic equation. So just pay attention to that. You want to look for the entire term if it's asking you for its entire term, rather than breaking it out into its individual component parts.